All right, next up we have Andrew Turner. Andrew, woo, gorgeous.
There's been a lot of math, which is very cool. So I'll take a slightly different perspective on this. So cities are very interesting. We talk interesting a lot here. We talk about Chapel Hill, we talk about Durham, we talk about cities as a place, as a thing, but really they're complex systems that have a lot of interleaving, interoperating parts. In fact, not even the physical parts that we see, the buildings and the roads and the parks, but invisible forces. They have things making it do things that are not always intuitive and approachable. Much like magnets, when you hold two magnets, sometimes they attract to one another, they turn one around, they pop apart. And it's not always understandable why that occurs. Until we can understand the awesome slides. Wow, these are really out of order. Until we can understand how we can visualize the fields themselves in them. Sometimes when you pop iron filings, you can also start visualizing the magnetic field space around it and start seeing and understanding the invisible forces of what's occurring. So it's really interesting when you start applying this to location and start seeing and understanding how you can start visualizing things through things like maps and cartography that we talked about. But understanding that space and time itself is fractal in nature. Benoit Mandelbrot was a famous mathematician who worked for IBM, who realized and discovered something called fractals, where you see these gorgeous, beautiful pictures which had awesome slides of, in which you could zoom into those fractals and it had recursive self-symmetry. As you zoomed in, new forms emerged that you couldn't have seen before, and it was only possible because of computers. For 300 years, they hypothesized about fractals and drawn them with their bare hands, but only when they had computers to visualize them could they explore into them. And so it's interesting we start applying this to the real world. Because the United Nations estimates that every single day, there are 2.5 quintillion bytes of data generated. That's 2.5 million terabytes of data every day. So massive amounts of data. So the question is how do you handle that? How do we actually begin to understand that? So Waldo Tobler offered up a concept called Tobler's First Law, in which he says everything's related to one another, but things nearby tend to be more related to each other. So we can apply this in a type of geographic sharding to understand how we can actually think about things in small ways at the levels of cities. And start seeing the fractal nature of the world, where coastlines themselves of oceans become coastlines of rivers. When the topography of the landscape becomes the topography of the buildings, and the more micro structures start emerging. Until you get down to the very local level, and you start understanding the topography of the sidewalk, and the trees, and the people. And then themselves, the people themselves, how they move across this landscape. You start observing them and what they do. And neighborhoods themselves become fascinating in terms of invisible forces. Because neighborhoods are where you fall in love. It's where you have your kids, you buy a house. It's where you get in fights, you bike to work every day. It's where you walk your dog. So it's how we live on these streets, what Jane Jacobs called sidewalk ballet, and moving through these spaces that becomes what makes the city itself more than just the shape of its buildings and its roads. But we have to understand how these things work together, because it is a city ensemble. Well, I can worry and care about my neighborhood and become an advocate for local park restoration or civic safety. I have to understand how that actually affects the city itself as a local citizen. Because with all this amazing data, we need to understand how we can leverage this data to answer our own personal questions, but also understand how that might be shared with other people, so we can look across these fractals at one another. So you can start considering civic engagement not just as a way in terms of which we're advocates about going to local council meetings, but in which we use digital information technology to help make the case for us and work with governments on these problems with the systems and tools that they already have today. Pew did a research study in April 2015 in which they surveyed a number of citizens and asked how many times do you go to your government website looking for data about your school, about your neighborhood, about your society. 65% went and looked for data, but it said less than 10% of those same survey said that the government did a good job doing that, right? So that's what we've heard a lot of here in Chapel Hill, Durham, Raleigh, Wake County, are all doing an amazing job answering that question. So with data like that, and now access to tools, software, mobile devices, we can now become data-driven citizens. We no longer merely advocates through petitions and saying, I don't want it in my backyard, but you can say, I don't like that, and I've analyzed the local liquor laws and the change over time, and I think this is going to be a problem. Here's my map, or here's my chart of that. And if they don't believe you, well, I'll come back in 6 months and analyze how it's changed over time. So now we have the ability to not just use data and tools to understand the macro scale of things, but also understand the micro scale and how people actually move through them. What I call neo-geography, the idea of telling your own personal story, your own personal perspective. And through doing this, through this neo-geography, we actually form a new landscape. You can't even see this social topography in which the hills become the magnetic attractors of where people move to. across the whole city, but even myself, where do I go? Where do people, my neighbors go? How do we shape and change the city over time? And this starts informing the city. We can actually do cultural core samples through the city itself to understand now how the city is moving, how it's shaping. What are the invisible fields that form the city complex system that actually inform how it's changing over time? Where it is today, where it's been in the past, and where it might be going to in the future. So I challenge and propel you to become your own neo-geographer. Use these tools and data to tell your own local story. They're easy, they're free to do. Share that with other people, help teach one another, and look forward to seeing the maps and answers you make. Thank you.